Hey, it's Nathan, and today, before I make any math videos this summer, I just wanted to talk about how PhD stuff was going and do a little update there, because people seem to appreciate those, and it also helps me sort of orient myself towards what my goals are going forward. And those have been very unclear as of late. There's been a portable AC unit with this very, very loud fan going off in my apartment for like around the past month. And so I haven't been able to think straight in my apartment, which has not been fun. So I've been spending a lot of time in my office, a lot of time doing background research for research projects and studying for my final test. So we got one test left. Before I talk about that, I wanted to talk about just like what just finished. So I just finished my second year of my PhD program, which is basically the master's component where I'm at. So if I wanted to, I could just be like, hey, I don't want to do a PhD anymore. Can I do a master's project and bounce? So I'm at the point where if I don't want to get a PhD, I can just master's out, which is not at all what I want to do. I don't want to do that at all. I think I would be very, very disappointed in myself if that's what I ended up doing. So that is not the plan. But at this point, it's kind of weird because there's people in my cohort who are master's students who have now graduated, and there's other master's students who want to move up into the PhD program who need to pass a PhD qualifying exam in order to do so. And I'm kind of in a weird boat where I came in as a PhD student and I've already passed a qualifying exam. So I'm in the PhD boat and I don't have to pass my next qual until the end of not this coming January, but the January after that. So I have a little bit of time to pass my last test. So I took three classes this semester, one of which was a reading class with my now advisor, and that was a big focus, or like I put a lot of effort into it because it was the class that sort of determined who my advisor was, and that's where I thought most of my time should have been spent. And then I had the two second semester core classes for the core subjects of complex analysis and topology at my institution, which I didn't really care about. It was bad in terms of like going from someone who is usually very academically motivated, performs very well on tests, and really cares about their academic performance, to what was this semester, which was, this is all busy work and I don't want to do it. And I think I just finally hit the point in my academic career where I am tired of being tested on material, because I feel that in some respect, I can communicate certain dense topics in mathematics, and tests feel annoying to me now. And it's, okay, this is not to say that I know it. That's far from the case in many of these subject areas, especially in complex analysis. I do not have a good handle on complex analysis right now. It's going to be a big part of things that I think about research-wise, so I'll get more practice there and I'll be able to sort of recoup some of that knowledge, but it won't be in like a test setting. Yeah, so I think I'm just really burnt out on the testing process, and it's a really bad time to be burnt out on the testing process because I have one big, huge exam that I need to take in August, and it's my, theoretically, if I don't take any courses that require me to take tests, it will be my last academic test of my lifetime, which is very cool to think about, because I don't want it anymore. I don't want the academic validation of getting a paper back and saying you passed. I want the academic validation of being able to take mathematical material and be creative with it and develop something new. And because of that, because I know that there's this like big test out there that I need to pass, and then there's all these like research ideas and thoughts that I want to pursue, it's really skewed my focus and made it very hard to, it's made it very hard to think about research things, because it's like, well, if I don't pass this test, then I don't get to do this research stuff that I want to do. And so it's like, oh, just put it on the back burner. You don't need to think about it. You don't need to have those ideas on hand. But then once I pass that test, I'm sort of like, well, now I have no research direction, right? Or at least that's how it feels right now. I do have a few projects that I'm like reading background on that are potential, like may become my thesis things, in the background that I'm reading about. But I haven't read enough to really understand the question posed yet. So I've got like a whole laundry list of readings that my advisor gave me that I need to work through, that sort of like make the statement of the question make sense, if that, makes sense. I'm very flustered, if that is not clear. I am sort of like all over the place. So I do have this thing here that I have written out that is like sort of an outline of things that I wanted to talk about when I got on camera to do this after, you know, not doing it for so long. But I think I blitzed through most of it. I talked about PhD stuff. I talked about test exhaustion. I talked about how classes went, sort of. I mean, if I haven't put them on screen yet, like here were my grades. I got a B in complex. I was very disappointed, but also I like could not care less because I just don't want that type of academic validation anymore. I just want to start thinking about problems because it feels like I've done nothing for 2 years in some sense. I guess that's sort of what you have to do sometimes because you have to demonstrate that you are capable of assimilating all of this complex information before you can actually apply it to a research question. So, well, I've mentioned it, but I haven't really talked about it in depth. What is my last test? So if you've seen any of these, you know that I took 2 PhD qualifying exams last summer, namely the Real Analysis PhD qualifying exam and the algebra one, and I totally bombed the algebra one, or, well, at least I felt like I totally bombed it, and then I was told that I barely not passed, and that was made me feel even worse. But anyway, not important. And then analysis, I like got a perfect score apparently, which was a big relief because it was like that was a test where I took it and I was like, if I failed it, I absolutely have no idea what was going on, but I'm pretty sure that I knew what was going on sort of situation. So I'm done with one of my PhD qualifying exams, and I just need to pass another one in some subject area, and I've decided not to fall into the sunk cost fallacy with algebra and just went ahead and said, topology is more important to my research area. I should learn some topology. So I'll be taking the topology qualifying exam this coming August, right before school starts up, and this is all of the things that will come up on that test, or at least in some fashion. It's more definition heavy, I would say, than the other exams, because there's just a lot of topological concepts that are, you know, they have some words connected to them, and the arguments connected to those words are not necessarily straightforward. So you've got things like, how does different versions of connectedness relate to each other? How do different versions of compactness relate to each other? How do separability axioms relate to each other? What are counterexamples for certain implications of these different properties and stuff like that? So it is a point set topology heavy exam, and there's usually some like ordinal topology stuff that comes up, which is just a special case of the order topology. It's just on like a on an ordinal instead of on a, something like the real line or the rationals where you could put orders on them. So I'm studying for that right now. And I think I'll be like, I've been doing some Twitch stuff last semester where I was just like, as I was working through this reading course, and one of the reasons why I was super focused on it was because I was like forcing myself to practice at home, and how I was practicing at home was I was going on Twitch and I was like doing the arguments I would have to present to my advisor and the other student who was also under my advisor in our reading course, like the day after I did those Twitch streams. So That actually turned out to work really well for me. So I may be doing that for topology stuff soon. So those will start probably after this video comes out and whenever I find the time. Because life has been crazy. That's normal. That's normal. It's not like, that's, it's not, it's just, that's how I roll, I guess. I do way more than I probably should. So other things that happened last semester, that were exciting, besides the decision to take this test and to start like really focusing on topology and also getting an advisor and getting research questions that I don't understand at all yet. But I have a vague idea of where they're going to be within the mathematical universe, as well. So there's a graduate student seminar that I started when I came in my freshman year or my first year of my PhD, and the interest in that revived one of the dynamics seminars that one of the faculty members ran. So there's now like a faculty and student dynamic seminar on campus where we have like invited speakers and things, which was really cool because that was kind of one of my goals. By having the graduate group was to sort of be like, hey, there's enough interest here to bring this thing that died right before COVID started back. So this is totally rambly. I am very aware of that. And it's just because I just forgot that I enjoy doing this. And this whole me filming right now just makes me feel good. Which is, something I should do more often. Because I know it makes me feel good. I just, like, get in my head that, like, you have other things that are important. So there's a dynamic seminar now, which is great. I taught business calculus. I gave a talk in said dynamic seminar that was revived on the Curtis Hedlund Linden theorem as well. So is it here? I think it's here. It's been a long time since I pointed to a card, so I'm gonna say it's here. Hopefully. I always do this, and I think it's the TV side. It's the TV. The TV is what tells me where to point. So I think it's up here. It was about the Curtis Hedlund Linden theorem, which is like one of the fundamental theorems of symbolic dynamics. It tells you what types of maps are continuous and shift invariant. In terms of some shift of a group, and so you can then figure out what the space of factors is. All right, so if you know how to describe all of the factor maps, then you can also describe all of the topological factors of that system, and in some sense you might be able to globally study the space of all the factors of that system because of this theorem. It gives you a nice description of those continuous functions, or continuous shift invariant functions. Anyway, it's up there, it's long, it's super technical, it's more of like a grad level talk than an undergrad level talk, so do with it what you will. If you have some algebra background and you know a little bit about topology, you should be fine. But if not, and you just are interested in math, it's always good to see things that you don't understand, because later on down the line, when you read stuff, you'll be like, oh, I saw a talk on this, or oh, I saw a talk where this particular idea came up and was used, and I wasn't really sure what it was, and now I know. So it has been an eventful year, and it's an eventful summer. So I have a lot of things going on. This was very rambly, which is okay. I'm just happy that I am in front of a camera right now. A lot of things preventing me from doing this. Most of them are in my brain. I think this is a good place to like cut it. If you enjoyed it, you can like subscribe for more math stuff or just updates about PhD things. And that was out of order, but I'm gonna go now because I really just want to edit this and put it on the internet. So it'll be out soon. It's out now because I have just posted it. If it is, anyway, time is a weird construct. Anyway, yes, that's where we're gonna, yeah.